Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on a cross my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Yeah.
Worship this morning on behalf of Causend and Trinity High Wycombe churches. We welcome you. We come together on this Sunday before Advent to celebrate Christ the King. My thanks to Rosemary Reynolds, who provided those pictures during our reflection before worship began. And we're delighted this morning to have Chris Stratta speaking to us on behalf of the Leprosy Mission. We begin, as usual, by lighting the peace candle and pray that the peace of Christ may fill our hearts and our world. May Christ dwell in our hearts through faith, that we may be rooted and established in love, and may know the love of Christ, though it is beyond all measure. And to God be the glory in the Church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, for ever and ever. Amen. And so on this Sunday before Advent, as we celebrate Christ the King, we sing our opening hymn, the great Christ Triumphant. let us pray. Lord God, Creator, all life is yours, and all that has come to be has come through you, lives in your energy, takes breath from your will, is clothed in your beauty, your dignity, part of your world, valued and loved. Lord, we too are creators. Our shallow judgments create deep prejudice. Our lazy assumptions conceive misunderstanding. Our lack of love brings misery to birth. Teach us, Lord, to love what you have created. Help us to shed the arrogance that cocoons us and restricts our growth as human beings. Stretch our wings of understanding. Teach us to see people one by one, not to pigeonhole or categorize, not to hammer them into the mould of our own making, but to rejoice in every difference, to accept people as they are, each part of your creation, needing your love, showing something of your glory. So great and gracious God, join us with all your rainbow people of every time and nation, every race and colour, as we pray the prayer that Jesus gave us all. And we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our opening prayer was based on a prayer written by the late Eddie Askew, who worked for many years for the Leprosy Mission, alongside his artistic and writing work. We're delighted today to be focusing on the work of the Leprosy Mission, something that both churches have been supporting down the years. Today, with the help of Chris Stratta, our local regional officer, we'll look again at that work and how it is making a difference in so many lives. Chris is going to give a couple of short talks, and he'll also be joining us for virtual coffee after the service. That's at our usual Zoom link, and I hope you can join us for that as well. But now over to Chris to introduce his theme.
Hello, my name is Chris Stratta, and I'm your regional manager from the Leprosy Mission. I wonder what you think of when you hear the word leprosy. Maybe you think, isn't that just a really old disease that we read about in the Bible? Surely no one today has leprosy. Well, every 2 minutes, someone today is told they have leprosy for the first time. At the Leprosy Mission, we are passionate about finding people with leprosy, giving them the cure, and helping them to have the best life they can. In the Bible, we see Jesus reach out and heal someone with leprosy. In a way, we see our role as finishing the work Jesus started by bringing an end to this horrible disease. Now, children, I'm going to need your help. What I'd like you to do in your families, if you can line up in a row so that you can see the screen, but that you're all in a line next to each other. Now, the person who's at one end of your line, you are going to be the hand in our body.
You or me?
Now, the person at the end, I hope you like cooking, because I need you to do some lovely acting for me. I need you to stir a pot, perhaps a nice big pot of soup. Do some lovely stirring. Now, unfortunately, when you're stirring, your hand touches the hot pan. Now, before you can do anything, your hand needs to pass a message to the cleverest part of your body. That's right, the brain. So to pass a message from the hand up to the brain, we need some help. Now, our helpers are the messengers in our body. We call them the nerves. So people in the middle, you are the nerves, and at the other end, the brain. And together, in your family, you're a human body. Now, when your hand touches the hot pan as you're stirring, what do you think?
Ouch!
That's right, ouch! So pass your message, hand, ouch,
ouch,
to the nerves.
Yeah,
the nerves, you pass on, ouch, up to the brain, and the brain thinks, ouch.
Yow!
So what does the brain need to say to the hand? The brain needs to say, move your hand away, or something like that. So brain, you pass the message down to the nerves, to the hand, and hand, take your hand away.
Move the hand.
Move the hand.
Oh!
Now, in a healthy body, that's what happens. It's a bit quicker than that, hopefully. But the hand talks to the brain, and then the hand pulls itself away. This time, our nerves, our messengers, I'm afraid you're not working, so you can sit down. Again, hand, do your stirring. This time you touch the hot pan, you think,
ouch!
Now, if you want to pass a message to the brain, can you do it? No, sadly not, because there are no messengers. So brain, can you help? No, the brain can't talk to the hand either. So what will happen to the hand? Sadly, it will get burnt. That's what can happen to someone with leprosy. We might think pain is something bad, but actually pain is a good thing. It's a gift that helps us know when we're hurting ourselves. People with leprosy start to lose the ability to feel pain. So they can get hurt. When they're cooking, they might burn themselves. When they're working or gardening with their hands, they can get damaged by thorns or infectious things. Some people with leprosy are poor, and often they don't have shoes or sandals. And if they're walking on the ground, they can easily damage their feet and get ulcers. Sadly, that's what happened to my friend Fio in this picture. Fio lives in Myanmar, and can you see his leg here is in plaster of Paris? Fio had a really bad ulcer on his foot that got very infected. But the good news is he came to our leprosy mission hospital in Myanmar, and now he's getting help for his foot. He has a wife and a little boy. His life has been saved through coming to the hospital, and he's happy and so grateful because people like you make it possible for Fio to get healing for his foot. Thank you, children, for your lovely acting skills. I'm sorry I couldn't see you doing that acting, but I'm sure you did a really good job. So what can we learn? Well, firstly, we can thank God, can't we, for those of us who have healthy bodies, that we can feel pain and that our bodies work. That is a gift from God. And secondly, next time you hurt yourself, pray for people like Fio who have leprosy, who can't feel pain. Pray that God would care for them and give them what they need. That would be really kind if you would do that. Adults, I look forward to speaking to you a little bit later, and thank you so much, children and young people, for your lovely acting. God bless you.
And now we hear our Bible readings. First from the second book of Kings, the story of Naaman the leper. And Jeannie Bien is to read this with her family. And then we'll sing the Stuart Townsend version of the 23rd Psalm before our Gospel reading from John's Gospel, which focuses on Jesus, the Good Shepherd, who brings life and life in all its fullness. And that's to be read by David Reynolds. So let's listen for God's word to us today.
Bible reading, 2 Kings 5, verses 1 to 15a. Naaman, the commander of the Syrian army, was highly respected and esteemed by the king of Syria, because through Naaman, the Lord had given victory to the Syrian forces. He was a great soldier, but he suffered from a dreaded skin disease. In one of their raids against Israel, the Syrians had carried off a little Israelite girl who became a servant of Naaman's wife. One day, she said to her mistress, "I wish that my master could go to the prophet who lives in Samaria. He would cure him of his disease." When Naaman heard of this, he went to the king and told him what the girl had said. The king said, "Go to the king of Israel and take this letter to him." So Naaman set out, taking 30,000 pieces of silver, 6,000 pieces of gold, and 10 changes of fine clothes. The letter that he took read, "This letter will introduce my officer Naaman. I want you to cure him of his disease." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes in dismay and exclaimed, "How can the king of Syria expect me to cure this man? Does he think that I am God? With the power of life and death, it's plain that he is trying to start a quarrel with me." When the prophet Elisha heard what had happened, he sent word to the king, "Why are you so upset? Send the man to me, and I'll show him that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariot and stopped at the entrance to Elisha's house. Elisha sent a servant out to tell him to go and wash himself 7 times in the Jordan River, and he would be completely cured of his disease. But Naaman left in a rage, saying, "I thought he would at least come out to me, pray to the Lord his God, wave his hand over the diseased spot, and cure me. Besides, aren't the rivers of Abana and Farfar back in Damascus better than any river in Israel? I could have washed in them and been cured." His servants went up to him and said, "Sir, if the prophet had told you to do something difficult, you would have done it. Now, why can't you just wash yourself, as he said, and be cured?" So Naaman went down to the Jordan, dipped himself in it 7 times, as Elisha has instructed, and he was completely cured. His flesh became firm and healthy like that of a child. He returned to Elisha with all his men. That was the reading for today.
shepherd I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in trust, I will trust in you. And I will trust in trust, I will trust in you. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me home. He guides my ways in righteousness. And he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in trust, I will trust in, and I will trust in trust. Mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me home. And though I walk the darkest path, I will not fear the evil one. For you are with me, and your rod and staff are the comfort to know. And I will trust in trust, I will trust in, and I will trust in trust, I will trust in. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. And I will trust in trust, I will trust in trust, I will trust in. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home.
The reading this morning is from John chapter 10. Verses 1 to 10. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. And the gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him, because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him, because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full."
Good morning. Before we look at our Old Testament passage together and hear more about the work of the leprosy mission, let me tell you a little about my story. I grew up in Lyme Regis, a little seaside town in Dorset, and I was blessed that my parents took me along to Sunday school and church. As a boy, I can remember carrying heavy buckets of water up a steep hill in Lyme Regis to raise support for wells for people with leprosy. That's important because people with leprosy often don't have access to clean drinking water. But drinking water builds up the immunity over time, and therefore people with leprosy often have weak immune systems if they haven't had access to water. In fact, we haven't had leprosy in the UK indigenously for about 200 years because we have had access to clean drinking water. Leprosy sadly affects the poorest 5% of the world, who often don't have good sanitation or drinking water. Since those childhood memories, I've had a love of mission. And when I was 18, I felt God prompting me to go overseas and do some mission and to experience it there. And I thought to myself, it's scary, but as long as I get sent somewhere where the food isn't too spicy, I can hopefully cope. You've guessed it, I was sent to India, and I lived in New Delhi for 6 months, working in a church and in a school project. In that time, I also came across people with a number of health issues and disabilities. So often I thought, I'm just one person. I feel so small, what difference can I make in such a huge country to so many people? But God was kind and he showed me that I could make a difference to one or two while I was there. Something that I read many years later really resonated with me. Something written by Eddie Askew, former director of the Leprosy Mission. He said, "In life we make our mark, and however small it is our mark. May God grant that the mark I leave is the mark of the cross." In my working life, I worked in the secular workplace for many years. And then, about 2 years ago, I felt God prompting me to come and work for the Leprosy Mission. And it's been a real privilege to come and visit people like yourselves, albeit virtually, to say a huge thank you for the difference you make to people with leprosy. And I hope to encourage you by seeing some of that difference that you're making. It's a wonderful thing to transform a life. And what we feel is the little that we bring, God multiplies and does great things with. And we'll see that later in our passage today. I wonder, have you ever felt defined in a negative way by something about yourself or something in your past? It could be your religion, ethnicity, social background, a choice you've made, something you regret. It could be something different for many of us. But if that's you and that's how you feel, that is a sad and tough place to be in. For people to see you differently and treat you differently because of something about yourself. Perhaps we can empathise then with Naaman in our passage. He was a great man, a valiant soldier. He had an important reputation within the king's army, but he had leprosy. Leprosy defined Naaman. It would have affected the way that people saw and treated him. At the time in Israel, to have leprosy meant you were seen as unclean. That doesn't mean that Naaman was somehow seen as unhygienic. It means that he wasn't able to join in social life of God's people in the same way until his leprosy was cured and a priest had announced him as clean. For Naaman, leprosy then defined him in that negative way. He would have been seen as outside the family, really, until he had been cured and announced cured by the priest. But for many people today with leprosy, it's a similarly tough situation. People face stigma and can be defined by their leprosy. That was the experience of a young man called Nuhu. Nuhu got leprosy when he was 18. He lives in Nigeria and his mother took him to a local healer. Sadly, the treatment they gave him wasn't able to make a difference because you need multi-drug therapy to cure leprosy. Over 12 years later, Nuhu finally got the cure he needed from the Leprosy Mission. But by that point, his leprosy had become severe. He had bad damage to his right leg, and it had to be amputated below the knee. But worse than that, when Nuhu's wife discovered he had leprosy, she left him to care for their four children alone. Such a terrible and sad situation for Nuhu to find himself in. Can you imagine that sense of leprosy being so terrifying that you would leave behind your own children because you're so scared of it? That's why at the Leprosy Mission we work so hard to explain to people that leprosy doesn't need to be feared in that way. Nuhu, thankfully, has now had his life dramatically transformed. At the Leprosy Mission, we're passionate about reaching out to transform people's lives in the broadest sense, not just giving physical healing, but giving people that social, emotional, spiritual healing they need too. Jesus said he came to give life in all its fullness. We're so privileged to be able to reach out as the hands and feet of Jesus, in a sense seeking to finish the work that he started in transforming the lives of people with leprosy. Nuhu has experienced this wonderful transformation, and he's so grateful for the difference it has made to his life. We're going to watch a film clip now that shows you Chanchaga Orthopaedic Workshop. That's the place where Nuhu received his prosthetic leg. It's run by the Leprosy Mission and is such a great haven for people to come to receive help in their time of need.
I want to use this opportunity to welcome you to the Leprosy Mission Nigeria Orthopaedic Workshop situated in Chanchaga, Niger State. This workshop was established in 1998 with the primary objective of providing prosthetic limbs for people affected by leprosy free of charge to those who can't afford it. In my time of working with people affected by leprosy, it is the stories of isolation that impact me the most. Disabled by the disease, many people are unable to leave their homes. They are excluded by society and forgotten even by their families. But here at Chanchaga, we want to see people living with independence and live to the full. A prosthetic limb can provide just that. The Leprosy Mission Nigeria's Orthopedic Workshop has provided thousands of prosthetic devices and other assistive technologies to the people that we serve. One such person is Nuhu. His leprosy went undiagnosed for 12 years, and due to badly infected ulcers, his leg had to be amputated. When his wife heard about his leprosy, she walked out on him and left him alone with their four children. This is what he has to say now.
India Nuhu Ibirahi daga yongoji Allah hawti am be kuturu nangi am bo Allah hawti am ko moshini am don be gaddiya yongoji ay be kokki am koyngal be gaddiya daga no inde do dum shanshaga be kokki am koyngal mi godana kebe ami godana kebe har joni har jango bu kamba dorgo dia gommi na gode har gobe mission na Allah shaka mashu.
A prosthetic limb is life changing for Nuhu and his family. Nuhu told us, when I lost my leg, I will never go out and meet my friends and became depressed. But now this will completely change my life for the better. We are reminded in the Bible that Christ came that we might have life in all its fullness. Here at Chanchaga, we want to see people enjoying life in all its fullness, living independently, and playing an active role in their local communities. Sadly, there are many more people with disabilities just like Nuhu, who desperately need a prosthetic limb. You can provide someone like Nuhu with a prosthetic at Chanchaga. Please support them however you are able and give them lasting independence and freedom. Thank you and God bless you.
Thank you so much for transforming Nuhu's life. He can go back to working and to caring for his four children. That is wonderful. In our Old Testament reading, we saw how small choices can make a huge impact. Firstly, we see that it's actually a young servant girl who tells Naaman's wife about Elisha, that he has God's power to cure leprosy. Then later we see when Naaman seems reluctant and angry to go and wash in the River Jordan. His servants say to him, "Look, Elisha's asked you to do a small thing. If it asked you to do something bigger, you would have done that, so why not go and wash?" And Naaman listens. And so because of these small decisions, really, by a young servant girl and by Naaman's servants, people who might have seemed small in the grand scheme compared to the great man Naaman, it's through those things that remarkably Naaman is healed of his leprosy. Similarly, today, God uses what can feel like the little that I bring, and perhaps for you what feels like the little you bring, to make huge transformation for his kingdom, to change people with leprosy so that they don't have to be defined anymore by a disease. Thank you so much for partnering with us to transform lives. You might be thinking, yes, I'd like to know more about what I can do for people like Nuhu. Well, firstly, please do join me in praying for people affected by leprosy. The leprosy mission started simply with a couple, Alice and Wellesley Bailey, praying in their front room with their three friends for people they'd met in India with leprosy who really had nothing and no one to look after them. God honoured those prayers, and in his kindness he provided financially for what would become the leprosy mission. And now we're able to work in 5 countries in Africa and 5 in Asia to bring transformation. God is so kind to answer prayers. He's gracious, merciful. Please do pray with me. You can find prayer resources on our website, leprosymission.org.uk, or you can contact me too, and I'd be happy to post you prayer resources. Secondly, please give what you can for people like Nuhu. It costs £24 to cure someone of leprosy, and £500 to provide a prosthetic limb. Perhaps you might partner together with your friends, family, house group, church family, to make a difference for people like Nuhu. That would be a wonderful thing. Some of you might be thinking, I'd like to give regularly to transform more lives, and for the equivalent of a cup of coffee and a cake out and about once a month, you could cure 3 people of leprosy in a year. That would be fantastic. You can give on our website, you can give over the phone, or you can contact me and write to me. Thank you so much for sharing in this time of virtual worship together. I do hope you've been encouraged to see the difference you're making to people affected by leprosy. I would love to hear from you, to answer any questions and to hear your story. So please do get in touch with me. In the meantime, may God bless you.
Our thanks to Chris and for his challenge to us. And now we reflect on how we might share in the work of the leprosy mission now or in the months and year ahead, through giving or through praying, through our support. And we have some music and a few slides to help us reflect on that.
So we come to our prayers. Let us pray. Living God, we thank you for your love for the world, shown in Jesus Christ, who came that all might have life and life in its fullness. Use our prayers now in the work of your kingdom, a kingdom of justice, compassion, and peace. We thank you for the leprosy mission, which was born and cradled in prayer. We thank you for its faithful work over 140 years among the poorest people of the world, for the witness of its founder, Wellesley Bailey, and for its staff today, here in the UK and across the world. We thank you for Chris and his word of encouragement this morning. Bless him and all in the leprosy mission family, in their life and work together. We thank you for lives transformed, for the millions cured of leprosy, and the many helped in coping with the after effects of this disease. And we pray for those suffering leprosy from leprosy today and the stigma still attached to it. Bring healing, Lord. Bring your help. Show us our part to play. We thank you for all medical researchers. Grant wisdom and insight to those who are seeking the prevention and cure of leprosy and the diseases of our day, remembering especially the amazing work being done to develop a vaccine against coronavirus. We thank you, Lord, that the global nature of this fight against disease and for the ways people of different faiths and none have been brought together. We thank you for the faith leaders of Sri Lanka, setting aside the divisions of the past to work together to end leprosy and to support communities affected by the disease. Bless that work and bring healing to that nation. We pray for our government in its role in this work across the world and for the UK aid programme that it may be sustained, for wisdom, courage and generosity in all that is done through that aid programme. And we pray for the leaders of all nations that your spirit of integrity and truth may be at work and new beginnings may be made. We pray for our own communities and local councillors in the challenges they face, for our schools, our hospitals, and our nursing homes. We pray for all in the care and medical services, for your strength and encouragement at this time. May your light shine among them all. Make your people shine with the light of Christ. Help us to listen more attentively to the voice of the Good Shepherd, to share his work of bringing new life to the world. And so we pray for all on our hearts today, and in the quietness we lift them to you, family, friends, those who have asked for our prayers. Gracious God, surround them with your love and your peace. Lord, let your light shine in our lives. Accept our prayers, silent and spoken, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Saviour and our Lord. Amen.
And so our closing hymn. Lord, for the years, your love has kept and guided. And may that love keep and guide us today and in the months ahead. May the living God be a bright flame before us, a guiding star above us, a smooth path below us, and a kindly shepherd beside us. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us and all on our hearts this day and forevermore. Amen.